Bring those lights down. No, we're gonna it's like the scene out of Close Encounters of the Third Kind.
We've never seen that much light.
There are people out there. No, seriously, guys, bring those house lights down a little bit. Jeez. Well, good afternoon and welcome to Macworld San Francisco 2010. Yeah. We made it. My name is David Biedny, and I'm hosting this special event here today, and the lights get brighter. This is the 20th anniversary celebration of Photoshop. 20 years of pixel domination. And I've been involved with that history for the past 20 years of my life, which, whew, and I decided to share this today with some old friends.
No, we're just young.
You're young, young friends. We have here at the extreme right hand of the stage, Russell Brown, Senior Creative Director at Adobe. That is your title, correct?
It is my current title. I have been at Adobe for 25 years.
A quarter of a century.
Yes, and I helped name the incredible product Adobe Illustrator 88, and it came out in 1989. So my claim to fame.
But it had a beautiful green box.
Yes, it did.
I remember the packaging well. Let's not get started with that yet.
Just sort of setting myself back in time there.
And here we are in the present. To my right is somebody whose name you might not recognize, but if you've been playing around with Macs since the beginning, you will know his software. This is an old friend, Jerry Harris, who is senior computer scientist at Adobe.
That's it.
I think of him as the father of the paintbrush tool, the painting engine in Photoshop 7, but forget that. Adobe brought him in to work on that because of what he had done before. What was that? Anybody remember Pixel Paint?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Pixel.
Jerry and his former partner, Keith McGregor, put together Pixel Paint a long time ago in a universe far, far away. And I just want to bring this up because there was a SIGGRAPH computer conference that I went to Atlanta to attend, and I visited you guys, and I mentioned this the other day, and you denied remembering this, but these guys had, and I'm not making this up, they had a mouse with a pressure-sensitive button. So you could paint with pressure sensitivity by applying different amounts of pressures to the mouse button.
Yeah, I think it never saw the light of day, though.
I don't think that thing ever came out, but man, what a revelation. Yeah. This was years before there was a Wacom tablet.
I think before that you had to get like a, anybody that used Quantel paint boxes back then, the only tablet you could get back then was this $2,000, I can't remember the name of the company, it was an English company. Thing weighed a ton. And people referred to digital painting back then as painting on glass because this tablet had a huge sheet of glass on it and it felt really slick. But that was a $2,000 input device, and this thing was aiming a good bit lower.
And probably had 100 pressure sensitivity pressure levels, if that.
We had a lot of gadgets that never saw the light of day.
There was a lot of stuff. Now, meanwhile, Photoshop obviously has become, well, and I know the times I've brought this up around Adobe people, I get in trouble, but it's become a verb. That's an amazing thing, and I know that there are certain...
You can use it as a verb, but I cannot
really?
In public.
We do not exist as a verb.
No, I can't.
All right. Well, I'll be the bad boy, then. I'll be the bad cop here.
I use the program from Adobe Systems to manipulate that photograph.
He's photoshopping it. That's what he's doing. It's a verb. Deal with it. When you reach the lexicon and the culture of being a verb, it just doesn't get... People don't go, I'm going to go... Apple my resume.
But would I Xerox something on an HP printer?
Oh, I don't know. Is there a lawyer in the house? Is there a lawyer in the house? No, we don't want there to be a lawyer. So what we want to do today was basically talk with you guys and give you some insights into how this program came to be, because there is this idea that Photoshop is the only image editing program that ever existed. That's not really true. There have been a number of bodies littering the roadside where there once stood viable competition, and it's sort of gone. But that's kind of a whole deeper philosophical discussion. But it's really important that that you showed up, Jerry, because you were part of that world. I mean, the thing about the history of image editing is that it didn't just start with Photoshop. Photoshop was the most elegant expression of what an image editor should be. There were other attempts to create programs that would address that market, and in fact, there are some great ideas that have been sort of lost in the sands of computer graphics history.
The sands of time.
In the sands of time.
We're talking 1989. Are you in 89?
I'm not in 89 yet.
Okay.
86, 87.
I'm back when the original Color Mac showed up, and I had the very first Color Mac to hit New York. It was a prototype unit. Apple Computer hated the fact that I somehow got this out of Cupertino. The New York office was flipping out, and especially when I announced that I was going to be doing a demo. I couldn't do this today, right, because Apple would have me killed. But back then, I was running the graphic special interest group of the New York Mac Users Group, and I announced publicly that we were going to show the first color Mac in New York City, and Apple hadn't announced the Mac 2 yet. It was like insane, and I got a call from the president of Apple New York, Ned Gaffney. He called me and said, "What the hell do you think you're doing, Biedny?"
Did he use that word?
Yes, he did. Okay. He said, "What the hell do you think you're doing?" And I said, "We're going to show a Mac 2. I don't have one yet, but I do. And I have really cool color software for it." "Really? Can I bring my guys to see this?" I said, "Sure." And they did. And it was insane. We had VideoWorks 2. Ooh. Running on a Mac 2. So people coming in to see a Mac 2 for the first time,
Video
and they were seeing
VideoWorks.
Color animation.
VideoWorks was with the icon of the skates. It had a little icon of skates, and you select the skate icon to move things or roll them around the screen, wasn't it?
You might be right.
It's true.
You might be right.
It was a little skate.
There were more innocent days. So one of the things that we thought we'd do, because there's all sorts of stuff we want to talk about, but for fun, and could we have the cameras show the computer screen, please, the video monitor.
Computer screen.
The display, computer screen.
Oh, no.
All right.
Oh, no.
Here we go. Photoshop 1.07. Wait, where's 1.0? Now, just for fun, Command-I, please.
Command-I, I can do that.
728 kilobytes.
No, who remembers this, and who remembers how to set their minimum and preferred size?
What happened? Photoshop got like me.
Where's the installer?
Jeez, where's the installer? It's shipped on a floppy disk. Photoshop 1.07. Now, little bit of trivia, and for those of you here at the show, I'm going to recommend you grab the free issue of Mac Life. That's floating around. This has a 20-year anniversary timeline that I wrote about Photoshop. It's an interesting fact. I'm gonna embarrass you. But actually, because you brought Photoshop with the right icon. You see, when Photoshop first got released by Adobe, the little one-hour photo booth icon, Adobe didn't like that. They wanted to make the eye, which became the iconic icon. So now I'm gonna get myself in a little trouble here. I was working at Industrial Light and Magic with John Knoll, and John came to me one day and he said, "I need a favor from you." I said, "What's that?" He said, "Get this out there." And he handed me a program.
You were the man.
I am responsible for this. John Knoll, one of the original co-creators of Photoshop, had written a piece of software that would go in and change the Adobe icon from the eye back to the one-hour photo booth. And he wanted this thing. He said, I don't want to freak Adobe out, but I figure you're a troublemaker, so could you, like, get this out there? Could you, like, get this into people's hands? Now, mind you, there was no internet then.
There was no get there out there.
There sort of was, and that's where it gets a little dicey, this whole conversation.
Sneakers?
What?
Sneakers and a floppy disk?
Well, no, there were modems, and there were things called BBS systems.
Oh.
Yeah, it's showing my age in the digital realm.
I don't remember that. Because
yeah, no, this is a long, long time ago.
I remember the CompuServe bills from those
days. In a galaxy far, far away. So Russell was good enough to bring with him today Photoshop 1.0, because I think it'd be instructive to see how far we've come in 20 years. Well, we've seen where we've come in terms of application size.
Yes.
It does a lot more now. Let's qualify this, right?
A lot more. I'm running this, by the way, with an emulator on my Intel Mac.
Unreal.
If you type this into Google search, you can find this emulator yourself, and you can even find a pirated copy of Photoshop out there in the
1.0?
1.0
really?
In the ether now. But I didn't tell them that they could do this.
You didn't hear that from here. There are other things that are going to be set up here today that you didn't hear us say.
Yes. What else?
There'll be something later on that I say that I know you didn't hear me saying. We'll bring it up later.
Don't you find it ironic, though, that the symbol for Photoshop is something that Photoshop had a part in doing away with?
That's right. That's right. The 1-hour photo booth.
My kids are probably because of Starbucks application.
You know? I don't know. They can remember the past. I just have to go through these simple menus.
Oh, man.
Even this menu. The chooser.
Chooser. Yeah. Keycaps. I love keycaps.
Yeah.
Keycaps rules.
So,
where are those weird hidden? This is like, all right, let's launch the software.
Okay,
let's see how fast it launches.
I'm going to launch two images. Is that okay? Or just
absolutely. Okay. Go for it.
Look, I can still drag and drop those in there. So,
how fast it loads. In emulation yet.
Wait, about.
So now these are iconic images, actually.
Wait, we just have to pause for a moment
and
see my name.
Oh.
That's it. That's my claim to fame.
Well, now here, hold on a second. In the Photoshop 1.0 manual, when you open up the documentation, I'm in the special thanks.
Ooh.
So, I'm not in the splash screen. I'm in the 1.0 documentation. So that's kind of cool.
And you told me about this one, the option key.
Right. So, okay, here's the thing. First Easter egg, if you go to About Photoshop, you hold down the option key and now do About Photoshop, you could reach John Knoll on the phone there.
It's his
that was his home office phone number. It's a true story.
I can't believe he did that.
He did do that. There was his P.O. box in San Rafael, at the San Rafael post office. So, crazy stuff.
So these are the two images that John Knoll brought to Adobe Systems in 1989. This one was called Jennifer in Paradise. This is his wife, taken that year in Tahiti.
Their honeymoon.
And when this photo came to Adobe, we used this for demos, but my boss asked me to paint in a strap. She was not wearing the strap. Everybody says we think we removed the strap, but she was not wearing one.
No, she wasn't.
And so we had to put in the little strap. It was my first little project, pasting that in there, so that when we went around with a demo, that it was okay for Jennifer to be in paradise. But imagine it's 1989. I'd worked on Quantel paint boxes and Cytex machines. When I say worked on them, that means you sat behind the person and they worked the mouse for you.
There was
for
an operator.
$800 an hour.
You rented a studio where you sat down and did nothing but.
So they would bring this up and you'd wanted to make a clone or move something around on this Quantel paint box or on a Cytex machine in those, in 1989. I think it was 86 I was doing some of that. So here it was, he walks in the door and he carries in his Mac and puts it on the table. I think it was he rolled it in. What's the machine I had back then, the FX?
Yeah,
you probably had a Mac FX, which had a whopping 30 megahertz processor.
68020, or 68040.
You could load it up with 32 megabytes of
32.
RAM. And you were cruising in style.
And I had a 13-inch monitor sitting
an
there on
top. An Apple 13-inch monitor with a 640 by 480 resolution.
You realize your iPhone outguns this machine now.
Pretty much.
So
now, there are a few things about this.
Yes,
that
what
are kind
else
of interesting.
Do we know about this photo?
Well, not so much about the photo itself. Go to mode for a second, if you would, Russell. Go to the mode menu. Yeah. Now, interesting point. We're not doing a Photoshop trivia thing here.
But what could they win? if we were.
Well, they could win the Russell Brown 20th anniversary
CD of special tips and techniques.
CD of tips and techniques
for Photoshop 1.0.
There's a big stack of them for Photoshop 1.0.
I should have put 1.0.
Oh,
on there.
That would have been perfect.
That would have been I didn't do that. I couldn't do that. This is John Knowles' version.
Well, open up mode again. Now, I'm going to publicly, now that I've got Russell and Jerry on stage.
Are you going to embarrass us?
No, I'm not going to embarrass you. Could you bring back the HSL and HSB color modes, please?
Would you like me to select this one?
Yeah. This is where it divides the image into three channels, hue, saturation, and lightness, and
brightness. Can I get those with command keys?
Can you get them with command keys? Oh, you can get to them, period.
So
HSL, baby.
Look at that.
It's not the same as LAB. In some ways, it's even more useful.
Well, have you complained to Mr. Knoll?
Have I complained?
And what was the reason we needed this?
So why would you need to break an image down to its hue, saturation, and lightness or brightness modes? Because for certain types of noise removal, for certain types of color correction, it's useful to attack the hue or the chromaticity of an image separately from the luminosity or the saturation. This was actually something that came up. And I'm going to be showing tomorrow. I've got a full-day Photoshop user summit. And what I'm going to be doing is showing some original files from the work I did at Industrial Light and Magic. And there were some techniques that I came up with that would have made great use of HSL and HSB as an intermediate mode. Some of those techniques now utilize LAB color.
I use LAB quite a bit, but I'd forgotten about these.
Yeah. No, I know. That's why I asked you to open them up.
Yeah, you're going to bring them back just so you can write a book about them.
No, I'm done writing Photoshop books. No more Photoshop books. But in fact, if you go back to image.
The image? Yes.
And you
how
see,
do you remember all
calculate, because.
Oh, calculate. Yes,
now,
yes.
It's just kind of funny because before Photoshop hit 1.0, I think it was 0.6 something, there was a hypotenuse command in there.
Who remembers a hypotenuse? I never.
I remember it, sadly. And actually,
in the interim, because of a lawsuit with Quantel,
you guys had to remove, add, and subtract
from Calcul.
I cannot make any public comments on this.
All right,
subject.
No public comments. But sadly, those, you know, if you go into calculations, that hasn't changed at all since version 1.0. And it would be nice to change. See that interface? That's like.
And there was a fellow by the name of Kai Krause who had like an entourage at every Macworld where he would just discuss the various uses of
this
dialogue.
Would discuss things, and as would I. Interestingly enough, just a little trivia. At a certain point, you guys acquired a company by the name of Aldus.
Oh, that,
right?
Yes.
Yeah. Aldus had a product called PhotoStyler, which was developed by a Taiwanese development house, if I'm not wrong. You lead software, I believe?
I think so.
And PhotoStyler's calculations menu, its dialogue, was actually the thing to emulate. Not that I would have actually brought that up in a book I wrote called Channel Chops at the end of a chapter called Calculations, showing a mock-up of what that should look like. I suppose you're still holding it over me that in the text of that book I wrote, nobody at Adobe is listening to me, so if anybody at Microsoft reads this, I'm available.
How's that worked out?
Well, you know. Anyway, well, it's worked out where you guys have no competition and you own the market. So you did okay.
I just want to go back in time.
Yeah.
Remember the resample mode here?
Yeah.
Resample.
Resample. You go in.
Which
oh, no, you said, oh, the other
it
one.
It was resize.
Resize. Image.
You go to image resize. There, you had the buttons to resize to the current screen or window.
Window.
So if you resize the window down, and then you said resize to window, it automatically give you the image in that smaller window ratio.
Boy, bring those back. Come on.
What? No, don't bring those back. No, that's fine.
Great.
And hey, wait a minute. Where is the... Oh, image... Oh, filter didn't have its own separate submenu yet.
No.
Right. So, yeah, Gaussian blur is still there.
Where's the lens blur?
There was no lens blur.
What are you talking about, lens blur?
Oh, I thought
it's where the displace command was, which is not there either.
Yeah. Right.
Displace came a little later. No, actually, go back to filters for a minute.
Filters. Yeah.
Blur more custom. Oh, yeah, you know, it's about time
custom.
You guys, yeah. So, nobody ever, who uses this? I'm curious, show of hands. All right, so tomorrow on the Power User Summit, I'm going to show people how to use this.
In 1.0?
No, in CS4, you silly man.
Okay.
I'm going to show them how to use this to move selections a half of a pixel or a third of a pixel in any direction. In Photoshop.
And who's excited about that possibility?
It's a power user summit. They're going to learn how to use this. Do you know that Photoshop Elements has this filter in it? It's true.
No.
Custom?
Custom is in Photoshop Elements.
Well, I'll have to look. I don't.
It really is. Okay. I swear to God, it is. One of those things where it's like, what the heck is this doing here?
But it is there. Absolutely. So it's been there since version 1.0.
Okay, I just have to show them. This is the one thing that sold me. Should I show them? So John Knowles there. I'd watched those people using $800 units, and he just took this lasso tool, went around Jennifer like this, held down the option key. I love the way this preview. Don't you love that preview? No preview. And he did that. And then he hid his selection, and I saw the soft edges on this. Mm-hmm. Soft edge selections. I'm going, what?
And you didn't even feather that.
Oh, I forgot to feather. You're
right. I was just saying, wait.
Of course. Undo. There's only one undo.
And that was good at the time.
Double
Real life had no Ooh. Undo.
Let's put a 10.
Ooh, lasso options feather.
I remember, Bob, it was 1982. I had a dream where I dropped a glass, and then I thought about undoing it. Anybody had that dream? Like, undo?
In 82?
No, 90. It was 92.
Oh, yeah. 92. 82. You could have made some money with
undo.
That.
Undo. Okay, so I set the
You set the feathering up.
To 10, and so I did this. And so that was just amazing, and that you can see it feathering that selection. And then drag it over.
Now you get a nice smooth. And then, there you go.
And then you
there's the Photoshop magic.
And I believe
twins?
It was,
They're
I
twins?
Believe this was the time I said, excuse me, I'm going over to John Warnock's office to tell him to buy this.
Now, mind you, there's something that needs to be said now.
What needs to be said?
Adobe ended up with Photoshop because there were a lot of really, how should we, oh yeah, ignorant and stupid companies that had a chance to acquire Photoshop and they didn't know what they were seeing.
I believe one of them said, do you know this story? John Knoll went to one of these unnamed sites and they said, how many of these things do you think you're gonna sell? there's no market for this. Do you think people are gonna play around with this?
Well, at that point, everything was bundled, right? I mean, we sold to Supermac and Premiere was through Supermac, actually Radius, right? You basically weren't, it wasn't useful without hardware.
So it's 1989.
In fact, this was sold with Barney Scan, right?
Yeah, Barney Scan. Who had a Barney Scan?
Okay. How long did you have to wait for a slide back then to scan? Okay.
They sold like 200 units of the Barney Scan. It was called Barney Scan XP.
Who bought a Barney Scan just so they could get Photoshop?
I did. Did you really?
Yes.
With Adobe money?
Yeah, with Adobe money.
Yeah, all right, okay.
But we didn't have digital cameras. And we had to scan everything on a flatbed or with the Barney Scan to get it in.
Well hold on. Now let's qualify that.
Yeah.
When I got my first copy of Photoshop, when I wasn't supposed to have it from a company that wasn't supposed to send it to me, I ran it on a Mac 2FX, and I had it hooked up to this FX. I had a GPIB interface board hooked up to my NuBus slot, and hooked up to that, I had a Howtech flatbed scanner. It was a 300 DPI scanner. It was like $8,000.
We had one of those.
Big, heavy boat. Remember that?
Yes.
Yep.
And the thing that we did with Photoshop was we did this Oldsmobile consumer computer project, this touchscreen kiosk thing, and we were using Photoshop to do animation frame by frame because nothing, and when I say nothing, I mean nothing, could take a 24-bit scan and dither it down to the 8-bit Mac system palette the way that Photoshop's indexed color mode was used. This is, by the way, something about imaging that is now vanishing. Your children will not know what an indexed color image is. They will not know. And I predict at some point the indexed color mode will be removed from the program that your company sells. Not yet, but at some point in the visible future, because no one's going to care. No one's going to care about reducing the colors and images because every display device is going to be 24-bit. We're not there yet.
It's just a compression technique now, right? It's just a...
That's right.
Make it easier on AT&T and such.
That's right. But at the time, we were doing software running with the VideoWorks player inside of HyperCard, and everything was an 8-bit system display, and nothing could dither an image into an 8-bit system palette. And would you actually please go to mode and go to index color?
HyperCard with a hyperdrive. Remember those?
I remember the hyperdrive.
And what would you like me to do?
I would like you to go to the mode menu and go to index color.
Yes.
Because this is where I spent my first 6 months in Photoshop. 8-bit system palette diffusion dither. Oh man. So instead of adaptive, which automatically generates an optimized color palette, that will use a system palette with a Floyd Steinberg diffusion dither down there on
Floyd
dither.
Floyd Steinberg? That could have been a quiz question.
I'm just saying. I mean, yeah, for we
have
would have them.
I have to get rid of these CDs.
Oh, don't worry, they're all taken. Don't worry.
Are they?
What?
I don't know if they want them.
Well, no, they'll want them.
Oh, okay.
Oh, I can promise you they'll want them. And if you click on OK now.
Click OK.
So this alone, that image represented, if you go back to the mode menu.
Yes.
I haven't used Photoshop 1 in a long time. Go to color table.
Color. Oh, I remember.
And go to edit table.
Oh.
Oh. Ah, yes. There is a Mac 8-bit system palette.
I heard that. Who was clapping?
Someone was clapping, right?
Who clapped? Who were
Jonathan, you remember this nightmare, right? This was our lives.
You want one of my CDs? You can have a CD if you clapped. I'll go deliver a few to it.
All right.
Okay.
So these were the 216 colors that were supported on every Mac display.
Hope it doesn't go freaking.
Interestingly enough, for those of you who came from web design, a variant of this was used to be called the Netscape palette. Remember the Netscape palette? You have to dither images
Scape
into the
palette.
Netscape palette. Wow. It was a variation of this.
Wow.
But this was where we went crazy with Photoshop. Early on, before Adobe ever saw it, before you guys even knew it existed. So nothing could do this. Nothing could take an image and dither it and make it look good in that color table. Nothing like Photoshop.
So before the time began with 1.0, you and John Knoll are working at ILM.
I wasn't working at ILM yet. I was back in New York. And I was evaluating technology acquisitions for a company that John went to potentially have published Photoshop. So they shipped it to me without John's knowledge.
Would this be Supermac?
I can't say who this was. Would this be Supermac? I don't know. Maybe. Yes, it was.
John showed it off to several companies.
He did.
And he admits that it was John Warnock who showed the greatest interest and the best knowledge of how important this could become.
I'm going to say this publicly now.
Okay.
Do you know who sent John to you?
You sent John to Adobe. You are responsible for us all sitting here right now.
As far as Adobe having the program, John Knoll called. What happened was Supermac sent it to me. They weren't supposed to. Yep. The FedEx package arrived on a Friday afternoon. I installed it on my Mac 2FX, and I started playing around with it. I started throwing stuff on my Howtech scanner. It was Saturday at about 9:30 in the morning when I realized I'd been up all night. Literally, there was
how
a time.
How many scans was that?
That was, it was, oh man, it was about four scans. And many, many, many iterations later, because I went insane with the calculations menu, but that's a whole nother story.
Sick.
I called up my friend at Supermac and said, whatever you do, acquire this.
We said the same.
You guys said
Supermac
the same thing.
Had been selling Pixel Paint. We thought, yeah, great acquisition. Go for it. Get us off the hook.
Yeah.
And you didn't do it.
It was a good thing. It's a good thing they didn't buy it.
Well, John went to some other companies, and there was well, what happened was, I get the software. I'm working with it now. I'm like going insane, and I'm writing down all the stuff. And I call Supermac, and I'm told, well, you can't speak to the author. And I'm like, really? And I went and found the phone number in the software.
Under option,
and I called him.
Oh.
I did. And I said, hi, John, you don't know who I am.
But I'm working with Photoshop. He's like, what? You're doing what? I said, yeah, I've got Photoshop. Where'd you get it? I can't tell you that yet. But I have feedback for you. And what ended up happening was John and I formed this really incredible friendship on the phone. And it wasn't until years later that I told him how I got a hold of it. But by that time, John had actually gotten me hired at Industrial Light and Magic to come work there. Okay. Because I got involved in writing the first book about Photoshop, which I ended up falling into almost by accident, really. Mm-hmm. Bantam had wanted me to do a book about freehand. And I had a version of Photoshop, and I said to my editor at Bantam, freehand? Screw that. I've got this other thing. And I don't want to tell this story publicly because it's delicate, but the editor and the publisher,
anyway.
Well, no, they came up to my office for a demo, and I had a picture that I retouched for them. It was a really iffy picture of a dead person. Mm. And I made the person look totally happy and healthy, and the Japanese publisher was horrified. He was like, ha! He was just, culturally, it was the worst thing I could do. But they were so impressed by the software. And Adobe hadn't acquired it yet that they said, well, who's going to publish this? And I said, I don't know. They said, well, you'll do a book about this? And I said, yeah. And the publisher said, but you won't include that image, right? Because this image that I use, which a friend of mine, a well-known character here in the San Francisco area back then, who would get in trouble all the time, that's for like another trade show for a whole other audience. He sent me this picture that was, again, really questionable. So when these Bantam executives came to my office, I had a picture of a dead guy in the morgue. And I said, watch this. I'm going to like fix him all up and make him look like he's like napping. And I did. And they were like, the Japanese publisher was horrified and fascinated at the same time. It was really kind of cool. And so they agreed to let me write this book, and it was like 3 months later that Adobe announced the acquisition, at which point my editor called me and said, do you realize the scoop you have? And I said, yeah. Oh, yeah. And so that book actually came out while I was at Industrial Light and Magic in 1991.
Here's a trivia question.
Yes.
Which film which director directed the first film that used Photoshop in that film?
It's not going to be Jim Cameron in The Abyss.
Yes, it was.
No, but you see, you have your trivia wrong.
Oh, no. Well, I lose the discs.
All right, you lose the discs. That's
James Cameron working on The Abyss?
No.
He's such a nobody. He didn't go anywhere, did he?
Avatar, that. No, I think he's working his way up. He's a very promising career. He's working on a movie out of boat, but
it's trivia is wrong. I know all my trivia.
To my knowledge, the very first movie in ILM where this got used was a matte painter by the name of Yusei Yuseji, who I believe used it to work on a matte painting for the second Die Hard movie. Mm.
Somebody look that up. Did Die Hard come out before The Abyss?
The second Die Hard movie.
Okay.
There's a shot of an airplane on a tarmac at night.
My source is John Knoll.
Well, then he's probably right. Okay. I'm not going to debate John Knoll.
Okay. That's interesting.
All right, we'll follow up on that. That's why I thought you'd say The Abyss.
You thought I'd say this.
I thought, and I was close.
I've got it. Wait, let's segue back to the screen. One more thing. The second thing that made me run out of the room.
Now, do you know the source of this image?
This is one of the first
digitally created
Pixar images. I know guy who wrote the code.
The shader for the render
the
shaders.
The reflections. Mm-hmm. That's what he spent 6 months on, getting this reflection.
Those were the days.
But this is the second demo. It's the magic wand tool. I've never seen the magic wand tool before. It's 1989, and somebody goes,
look, it's the water.
Then they hold down the shift key, and I said, ah! And so not only was that a section could we double-click here? You could double-click on that, and fuzziness.
Now, wait a minute.
What?
Well,
tolerance.
So
fuzziness.
Tolerance. Oh, okay, fuzz. All right.
You wonder where fuzziness came from. It's John Knoll, or it's Thomas that came up with fuzziness.
No, I think that might be Thomas came up with that.
Fuzziness.
Now, here's a little bit of trivia for you.
Trivia. Do I win? Can I win those discs
back? You might win those discs back.
Okay.
Discs are nothing. please hit cancel.
Okay.
Now,
I win.
If you go, no, we're not there yet. Image and adjust.
Image.
Image menu.
Oh, don't go outside. Image.
Adjust. Oh, no. Okay, one up. Map.
Map.
Now, see where Command M is arbitrary map? Please open that up.
Arbitrary map. Oh, no.
All right. Okay, now, so here's some trivia.
Oh, no.
This is the very first iteration of what was later to become curves. In Photoshop 1.0, there was no curves control. All there was this, where you could draw these weird solarization maps with a pencil.
Smooth.
To this day, the key command for arbitrary for the curves is still Command M. And people want to know where that comes from. It comes from map, arbitrary map. Mm. It was called arbitrary because you would draw these stupid things with the pencil tool and then hit smooth.
I know the answer. It was named after arbitrary map.
Get leave those fists alone. But notice there's no curves control because that came from feedback that the SciTex users gave Adobe that said, you know what, we need the ability of controlling the density of half tones, quarter tones, three-quarter tones. That's why arbitrary map is divided into those quadrants. That's why you have curves. Of course, you can, I believe, hold down the Option key while you press on the main area in curves now to get 10 percentile quadrants for people who think in terms of that way of thinking of density. But in the first version of Photoshop, no curves. It was just these crazy arbitrary maps, no ability of specking in and out, input and output values numerically, which is absolutely required for professional color correction that you'll all see if you're attending my Photoshop Power User Summit tomorrow. In this version of Photoshop, pretty much impossible to do real color correction.
Check this out. This.
Yeah.
But you know what? You
hold down the Shift key, and it draws a line between it.
Yeah, it draws straight line segments.
And that goes way
smooth.
It goes all the way back to first, and it still does that.
Yeah.
And then smooth, which really is a technique that is involved with a process called clamping that I'll be showing tomorrow as well. That's where the smooth command really comes from. The thing that people don't realize is that a bunch of this, and specifically...
Preview?
Huh? No, well, you know. Well, you better know this.
Okay.
What?
I'm ready.
No. You want those discs. You have more. They're your discs.
He's missing.
Jesus. if you could cancel out of this for a second.
Cancel.
The whole thing about the calculations commands that are in Photoshop is that they require multiple images to be the exact same size. That historically comes out of the fact that Photoshop, while Tom Lowell was developing it in Ann Arbor, Michigan, his brother John was really putting it into production use at Industrial Light and Magic. And at ILM, when you would get scan film frames, let's say for backgrounds or foreground spaceships to go in front, all of those film frames were pin registered, so they were all in precise alignment before they ever hit the compositing artist, and also the fact that they were always exactly the same physical pixel dimensions and resolution. That's where calculations came from. Calculations comes out of using Photoshop for motion picture special effects work.
What? Tell them about was it 20 or 50 machines they set up with actions to process?
Oh, we're gonna make. They're gonna be looking at us like we're insane.
It's just these days.
We had
a special script.
Well, it was even worse than that because there was no scripting. We had quick keys.
Quick keys. And how many machines?
Well, in our department, each one of us had two Mac 2FXs.
Yeah.
So we could be rendering on both of them at the same time, or render on one machine while designing a shot on another. And then I took my PowerBook 100 in and was typing up instructions on everything I was doing. And ILM management said to me, "What are you doing?" And I said, "I'm documenting what I'm doing." They're like, "We don't have time for that." I was like, "Really? You're going to reinvent the wheel every time?" "Sure." I said, "No, I'm documenting what I'm doing." And so we had two FXs, and we were using Photoshop to do frame by frame motion picture work. Now, there was no After Effects. What we would have given for After Effects, I won't tell you.
Frame by frame in
1991.
Okay.
So what we did was we had quick keys running on the machine.
Okay.
We'd have a folder in the Finder of the files to be processed. We would set up a quick key macro, and what the quick key macro would do would be to grab the first file in the folder list, drag it to a secondary folder, and drop it, which would move it out of the primary folder, moving the next file up.
Oh
Then it would open into Photoshop, do the things we had designed for the shot, save, and that was the, and then quit back to the Finder. So the next time you ran the macro, it would pick the first file on the list, which was always the last file that came up, drag it over. That would move everything up.
So this was a render farm?
This was batch rendering by hand. It was dreadfully painful, but did anybody see Terminator 2 here? Anybody see Terminator 2? Did anybody complain that Photoshop was used to do the effects? I don't think so. They saw a great movie. They're like, wow.
So it took weeks or months to process a
scene? I worked an average of 95 to 100 hours a week for a year.
Yikes.
It was really interesting. That's why I left.
The early days.
I was like, I've had enough. That's it. Movies, I still can't, to this day, I worked on Hook. Yeah, I know, right? There's the last. It's like saying I worked on Ishtar. You have no idea, ma'am. Yeah, give her all the discs. You're giving her all those discs? Are you nuts?
Look at that. Okay, The Abyss came out before Die Hard.
All right, okay. You win.
We have proof.
So I worked on Hook. And my job, one of my jobs, was to make Tinkerbell glow.
Ooh.
So I had to stare at Julia Roberts' face, like, all day long. To this day, I literally cannot watch movies with Julia Roberts. I get ill. I'm like, no, I can't do it. And there's a story behind that that I actually definitely cannot tell publicly.
Oh.
No, it's I could get in trouble with, like... Possession's 9/10 of the law, baby. But yeah, we did amazing things with Photoshop back then, frame by frame.
I wasn't listening to you earlier, but did you say why Lens Flare was created? What movie was Lens Flare created?
Lens Flare?
Lens Flare created for.
I want to say it was one of the Star Trek films.
That makes sense. Yeah.
Star Trek? Star Trek 6,
Undiscovered Country? I think Lens Flare, because I worked on that one, and I think that's right when John
did Lens
Flare.
Undiscovered Country, the best one of all.
No, it wasn't better than Wrath of Khan. It was good. It was one of the even movies, so it was good. It was 6.
Oh.
You know, that's how it works. The odd Star Trek movies, problem.
No, okay.
Like, that first one is kind of like Phantom Menace.
Oh, had nothing to do with it.
Oh, that's why Zachary's trying to dodge the next one, huh?
Yeah. Doesn't want to deal with it. There's a bit of a curse. Now wait, what else do we have in Photoshop 1.0 here, Russell?
I think the big thing you had on all of the competitor programs at the time was it was useful for printing, where none of us were. We took forever. You paged forever. You couldn't interrupt operations.
Color Studio.
Image Studio and Color Studio. Yeah. Which Color Studio was too much money. Color Studio did great things. Color Studio had the shapes implementation.
Yeah.
Vector-based layer that you could selectively rasterize into the bitmap layer.
Color Studio users.
Any Color Studio users?
Ooh.
Good stuff. Was great stuff.
How about live picture users?
Live picture.
Are you still using it today?
No.
How about Studio 8? Does anybody remember that? That's the one I think if...
Electronic Arts, Studio 1, Studio 8, and Studio 32.
Honestly, that was a solid program back then.
It was really good.
Like Photoshop was solid, but they didn't. They just dropped the ball.
Electronic Arts got wrapped up in games. They got sidetracked. Actually, Studio 1 did some really cool animation stuff. And I hate to bring this up, but something that it
hates to bring this up.
What? No, I hate to bring it up.
I can't tell you this.
But yeah, there was a perspective plane filter. It's real 80s. You could take your image and tile it into a perspective plane going off into the distance. It'd be nice to have that in Photoshop, maybe.
Yeah,
kind of fun. Retro, very retro. What? No, it'd be good.
I think about every program.
You can talk about the future? Was that your segue to talk about the future?
Well, you said I can't talk about the future.
No, you can tell him it.
All right, I got a story.
Tell him.
And I actually asked, I shouldn't say this. All right.
Oh, he's standing.
So people want to know about, like, the future of Photoshop, right? Well, technically speaking, they can't talk about it. And I can't, except for one thing. Do you love the YouTube? I love YouTube. You know why? Sometimes I go on YouTube and I type things in. Silly things, like, you know, CS4. Sometimes I type in CS 4.1 sometimes, and it's interesting to see what shows up. Oh no, we can't. It won't let you on.
What's wrong? Can I?
Because no, you can't see us. Because then you'll
I shouldn't do that.
No,
then you'll have people.
You don't want to do that because then we're showing.
That would be. I would be involved.
So if they go home and they go into YouTube and they type CS, what? There's something that might come up that might be really interesting.
Hey.
What?
High five.
We heard your comments.
So they're not going to try this. They're not going to see what new technologies are at work in the lab that might make it into a future version of the program that are demonstrated really well on YouTube. I didn't say anything.
No, you didn't.
I'm just sort of, I'm giving
them
the keys
to
the car. I'm not telling them
to
drive.
To YouTube. He didn't tell them to type in anything after
CS4. No, nothing inappropriate.
We'll show them the brush tool before they, the brush tool back then.
I have one question.
Yeah.
Is what's on YouTube, is it a good demo?
It's your demo.
Dude, it's fabulous.
It's your demo.
It's really good.
It's my demo.
Yeah.
It might be your demo.
How did they get my demo?
What do I know? I didn't put it up on YouTube.
So before you look at that demo, look at what was here 20 years ago.
Okay, what are we looking at?
Double-click the brush tool.
Double-click the brush tool.
This was your entire, down, there you go. That's your entire brush.
I love that.
That was your brush.
Look, it had the modes. There's no multiply, though, there.
Okay, how do I make that bigger? Nope.
You want
it
bigger?
Command key and the plus key? No.
No, not here. It could happen.
It didn't get. But that was the other feature that I liked was the soft edge brushes, adjusting the opacity of the brushes. That in itself, just the ability to change the opacity.
I think you could actually change it with the number keys in that version of Photoshop.
Try it out. So here's 50%.
If you type in,
I touch the number two key?
No. All right. Did you add that to later photo? Was that your idea?
It was my idea. Okay, I am going to show you my one contribution that I believe was my best contribution.
All right.
I called up Thomas Knoll and I said, these early days, it's pixels. I had no idea what resolution meant. And the only reference I had was, how big will this print when I hit the command key?
Yeah.
And so, Thomas, would you add this so that when you click here on the size, it shows me how big it'll be on a piece of paper when it prints.
Mm.
That's my claim to fame.
Yes.
That's it. Okay.
Which was a great thing because also this was a great way to explain to people what resolution was in terms of the size of pixels, how it affected the size of the overall output for the image. This is a great educational tool.
It was like, I don't know how big this is going to be, but if I add more pixels, it'll fit in this page, or I squeeze it down.
Well, now we're showing off.
Yes. Oh, right. Sure. What did you add?
No. There was one thing I spec in Photoshop 1.0.
Yes.
So could you click on the paintbrush tool and bring it out on the screen again? No. Just click it and bring it out. No. Click on OK.
Click on OK.
Yeah. Just bring it out on the screen.
OK. Sorry. Yes.
So move it around.
Move it around.
You see, you have that little icon of the paintbrush.
Yes.
I thought that was the goofiest thing in the world. And
so,
I said, you know what?
I need precision.
So
caps lock.
Caps lock. I tried that. There it is.
Crosshairs.
Crosshairs. Can they see that?
Do you know how I had a fight for that?
So you brought that in, huh?
That's me.
Okay.
That's right. It's a little piece of my DNA.
Did you add anything in here?
Well, that? Jerry. I'm sure I have some DNA in it, but not
in
that version.
In those days,
what you do now?
If you called up Thomas Knoll, I like the meetings we'd have on making decisions. Do you like it? I like it. Let's put it in. Meeting's over.
Well, you know, back then more programming.
I won't tell you what it's like at Adobe now.
And not only is that true, but if you would, please go to Image Filter Distort.
Whoa.
Because this involves
image,
a little bit of Jerry's actually.
Filter.
There is a little
distort.
Bit of you in here in a way. So if you'd go to.
Where's Distort?
No, I think that's what made Photoshop
you
special.
You don't have the Distort plugins. What have you done?
This is 1.07.
But there were, see, so I was using Pixel Paint, and I love
Pixel Paint.
Now, this ties into Pixel Paint.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And I was messing around with this graphics programming language called Pico.
Oh, yeah.
And Pico had a bunch of really interesting distortions into it.
Instant
built into it.
Okay.
And I had actually called Keith up
And Keith in Pixel Paint had taken, I think it was the warp command in Pixel Paint, and if you used the number keys along the top of the keyboard, as you held different ones down, they would give you different distortions. I think with warp, if I'm not wrong, in Pixel Paint. And Keith had put those in there because I had been talking to him about Pico. And I ended up in the same discussion with John Knoll about distortion effects. And that's where wave, zigzag, twirl, and all of that came out of was a discussion I had with John where he took like 2 days, coded a bunch of distortion filters, and then he called me up and he said, fire up your modem. I'm going to send these things over.
Hours later?
Was that a...
It was a 9600 baud modem.
Ooh!
Hey, it was a U.S.
Had,
robotics 9600 baud modem.
I only had the 2400.
It rocked. Oh, well, you know. You got to spend that Adobe money. Yeah,
call waiting was your enemy back then.
Oh, yeah. Call one click with the call. You'd have to turn the call waiting off before you made the call. And he sent me those distortion plugins. And they came out of conversations I had with John about stuff that you guys had built with Pixel Paint. And so those were actually the very first external plugins for Photoshop. You don't have them because you only brought the base program. So you're lacking those plugins. And actually, Adobe made John write a separate little manual for them with the Jennifer in Paradise
images.
Software
manual.
Yeah, that was in the box. And so Adobe, you would have to, I think, drag them on separately. That's why you don't have them.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, so which version did the foreground and background color thing change?
Three?
Is that a quiz question?
I don't know. I also don't know.
So if you click,
we had it like Photoshop has it.
Yeah. So that's your foreground color, and then the white is the background color. So anywhere you click on the white, it will open up the background color. Yeah. So it's that whole field around the foreground color.
Wow, that has hardly changed at all.
Now you got the two chips. I actually kind of like that. I think that was fine.
Why would they even want to upgrade from 1.0?
No dodge and burn. And there is something it's got to be pointed out now.
What?
The single greatest feature ever added to Photoshop in the history of the program.
History?
Close. Conspicuously absent from version 1.0. No layers.
Oh, gosh.
Yeah. No layers. This is when you had to know what alpha channels were and how they worked to composite images. That's why Calculate was useful.
People built careers upon not having that feature.
No, I know. That's true. That's true. Layers made it all so damn easy.
It wasn't available until later, but you could.
Yeah, at that point, Photoshop really lagged behind everybody else as far as features, but what it always had was quality. It never crashed. It paged the disk better than you could interrupt operations. Yep. And you know what? The biggest market back then was printing, right? How else could you get the stuff out? You had to send it to pre-press, right? So CMYK editing and...
Multimedia. CD-ROM was... That's what my company
Yeah, that's true. CD-ROM games back then.
So CD-ROM multimedia presentations with things like VideoWorks and HyperCard. That's how we came into Photoshop at Incredible Interactivity, was really, again, more about the dithering abilities and the painting abilities.
Excuse me one moment, he's taking a picture of me.
You are like a kosher ham.
I just had to look professional there for a while. Please continue.
Jesus. How do you follow that up?
But wait, do you remember in Photoshop 3, you could remember the art of floating selections, and you could use the Option key to deselect a portion of it.
Absolutely. Yes. Oh. I think you can do that.
No, I can't do this here.
No.
Oh! We also forgot.
What?
The other thing that he demoed was the cloning. Cloning. How did you start a clone?
No, you have to Option click.
I did it. Oh, that did.
No.
Could not.
What does it say?
Oh, you're in index color mode, you silly man.
Yeah. Who put me
you're
in index?
You're in index color mode.
Who
of course you
there?
Can't clone.
Who put me in that
You have to be in RGB mode, you silly user.
Okay.
You. There you
okay,
go.
Okay, that's the other thing. I think that's when I ran screaming out of the room.
Did Warnick?
It's a mountain in the air.
Warnick?
Yeah. Oh, that was cool. Yeah, that was my first. I think this is about the time. Yeah, and I went on the Today Show with this.
You really?
Oh, yes. With Deborah Norville. Now it's Deborah Norville.
With the strap, did you have the strap on Jennifer?
You can't trust images anymore. Here to talk about this.
She would describe me as a criminal in that video.
But such a smooth criminal.
And I said, and I had hair back then, I said, I'll do anything. I mean, I love this tool. And I think it was Rick Smolin. Rick was on the show with me. And he would move, Rick would move pyramids. He'll do anything to a cover of one of his books, and I'll do anything. And there was another gentleman on the show who said, this is terrible, like this is foul, will never happen.
Well, National Geographic got in all that trouble with that.
That was right about that time.
They
moved the pyramids and then never move anything now. They won't even take a scratch out of an image.
No.
Yes.
Purity of images. Yeah. It's a silly notion, really.
Yes.
Yeah.
Those were the days.
So just the clone bunch tool. Of pixels.
How many people, when they first saw the clone tool, created the third eye, just moved it right here? Come on.
That's like the first thing I did.
Yeah, it's the first thing you did. I never did that.
Actually, anymore. You know what? The very first thing that was a clone tool was remove the stitches in the guy's head where they had removed his brain for study from that demo. You'll hear about this later.
I introduced layers, Photoshop 3, a Macworld back in 94. And my demo at the time was an image of Hillary Clinton. And she was dressed like Barbie. It was a Barbie doll. And she had all these clothes on. And I was proving how layers, you could take her underwear off without taking off her dress, you know?
And Bill called you later that evening.
I'm glad none of my bosses saw that demo. You don't remember that. Anybody remember that?
I actually remember that. I remember you doing that demo.
Bad.
Good.
The things we did, bad things.
But we've come a long way though.
Since underwear demos,
since even layers, you know. And the thing is that people have come to expect Photoshop to lead the way, and it's still, you know, people complain. No one's complaining here today about, you know, certain corporate issues, but it's funny. Everybody's still using Photoshop. It's not like anybody's found something better to use, because there is nothing better. Because there is something to be said for 20 years of being vital, of being viable, of being ingrained in our culture. I mean, you know, we those of us who work with images, we don't want to remember the time before Photoshop, seriously.
We can Photoshop things all the time.
Whoops.
That's back.
Oh, man.
I deliberately did that.
Well, listen,
you're closing the session.
Yeah, we're kind of out of time.
Go ahead, close the session.
So I want to thank you guys. I want to thank you, and I'd like the audience to thank these fine gentlemen.
We will have to, and they have to clap for John and Thomas Knoll for really making it.
John and Tom Knoll.
Changed my life. It just everything about it.
They changed all of our lives. All of our lives have been changed, I think, in a positive way because of this tool. So thank you guys
for
doing this. And thanks everybody for showing up to Macworld. It's more than just Apple. You know, this is what it's about. It's about the tools that have grown around us. And Photoshop, first two versions, Mac only.
Yeah.
All right. Thanks everybody.
Thanks so
enjoy the show. Appreciate you coming out today. Thank you, Russell and Jerry. Thanks.